Oh, hello there. Greetings, and welcome to the return of the Anti-Furry Roadshow, where we look through various examples of furry art and artists from time before the fandom, and everything was in black and white. You can call me Game Popper. I'm a researcher and amateur historian specializing in fandom history. My main interest is around the furry fandom in the United Kingdom, and I also enjoy researching and looking at classical animations and illustrations from the 20th century. I am very excited to be back with more realistic, characteristic, light-hearted, and downright creepy furry antiquities of the world that they had to offer from many decades past, where I am joined by my co-host and fellow fan of historian.
Oh, hello there. Welcome to Anti-Furries Part 2. The sequel to last year's panel. Unfortunately, we're all stuck inside again. But not to worry, because we have plenty of animal-related media to take a little nosy at. I'm Amethyst, or Beetle, and I'm a furry artist and fursuiter. Hello. I quite enjoy history, especially when it pertains to animal people, just another fancy contemporary clothing, or I'm rather amused when I see people trying to dress as animal people and not quite getting it right. Amused. Oh, come on, you have to let me cowslip one pun in there. Ha ha!
In last year's panel, we talked about the dashing rogue Reynard the Fox, a sly but heroic character. This canid is not so much. The big bad wolf is an archetypal predatory antagonist, a classic bad guy. While he first showed up in Aesop's fables, such as The Boy Who Cried Wolf and The Wolf in Sheep's Clothing, perhaps the best known story the wolf has a role in is Little Red Riding Hood. The story has origins in 10th century Europe as spoken word, but the version most known today was written by Jeanette and Marie Hassenflug, then published and later adapted by the brothers Grimm. Real wolves are smart enough to stay away from humans most of the time, but the wilderness they inhabit can pose a real danger to unwary people, especially children. And such tales were crafted to demonstrate being cautious of nature. As the wolf became more anthropomorphized, he came to represent untrustworthy strangers and other diverse fears. The story has been studied for centuries, with interpretations ranging from symbolizing natural cycles, with Red Riding Hood as the sun, the wolf as the night, with the beast eating her representing dusk, and her gory escape from the wolf's belly symbolizing daybreak, to academics seeing the symbolism of maturing to womanhood in the tale. 1984's The Company of Wolves leans heavily on this interpretation.
This is where legend ends and survival begins. Where the dreams of childhood hold no promise of a happy ending.
Big eyes, you.
Co-written by Angela Carter and based on two stories from The Bloody Chamber, a collection of short fairy tale adaptions that she authored. The film follows Rosaline, a young girl dreaming that she lives in a fantasy forest and her adventures there, with various wolfish tales told along the way. In this clip, a young witch curses nobles who have wronged her.
The wolves in the forest are more decent.
The big bad wolves here are played by Belgian shepherd dogs, as are most of the wolves in this film, with one exception, due to the director being scared that the actual lupine actor might really turn into a big bad wolf and attack the young actress. Disney's take on the character, also known as Zeke Midas Wolf or Brer Wolf, debuted in 1933's The Three Little Pigs. The cartoon introduced the wolves' theme song, Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf, written by Frank Churchill.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Big bad wolf, big bad wolf. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf?
The original fairy tale ended much darker, with Little Red simply being gobbled up. The later adaptions, featuring the rescuer woodsman and his impromptu surgical switcheroo on the wolf, came from another fairy tale starring the big bad. The lesser known, The Wolf and the Seven Young Goats, tells of how a sly wolf attempts to trick a tribe of goat kids into letting him into their house while their mother is out. The mother goat tells the children that they'll know that she's home by her sweet voice and white feet. The wolf takes advantage of this by sweetening his voice with honey, then coating his dark fur with stolen flour. The wolf is let in and gobbles up the goats. When mother goat arrives, she's distraught to find an empty, wrecked house. That is until she sees a rather fat wolf sleeping under a tree. She quickly takes scissors, a needle, and thread. She cuts open the wolf's belly, retrieves her kids, then places heavy rocks inside and stitches him back up. When the wolf does wake up, he heads to the river, or well, for a drink, where he falls in and drowns. And so the goats all live happily ever after. This tale has been adapted too, although it seems more popular in European countries. The cartoon featuring the very wiggly wolf is 1957's The Wolf and the Seven Little Goats by Russian studio Soyuz Multfilm and animated by Peter N. Nosov. You'll hear more about Soviet cartoons later in this panel. In 1976, the musical Mama was released, a Romanian, Soviet, French co-production, this time with live actors in animal-inspired outfits with very big hair pieces. Loosely based on the fairy tale, minus a couple of goats, Titi Suru, the wolf, gains a gang in this adaptation, and is more interested in rather the goat's heart, or perhaps her gold, than eating her offspring. The movie was filmed simultaneously in three languages, Romanian, Russian, and English, and the cast was formed with dancers from various circuses and ballet troupes. We'll keep the wolves at bay and end this section with Jeff Goldblum playing the role in Fairy Tale Theatre's adaptation of The Three Little Pigs.
Later, I'm busy.
No, this is it. Let's go. Open up.
It's a wolf! Where do I hide? Nowhere.
See, I got dinner guests coming and you're the main course, so come on, open up.
No, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin.
Okay, listen up, because I'm only going to say this once. Open the door. Or I'm going to huff and I'm going to puff and, I'm going to blow your house in. What do you think of that?
But it's brand new.
Don't say I didn't warn you. Nice shot. Suey, suey, suey. Here, pig, 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 pig. Come to Uncle Bucky. Where'd they go? Here, little pig. Where is it? Where'd it go? I don't understand it. I know there was a pig in here. Blew the whole thing in and no pig.
If you've ever looked up vintage or antique furries before, you've likely stumbled across these detailed lithographs. In fact, we used a couple in last year's panel. Jean-Ignace Isidore Girard was a French cartoonist. Born in 1803 to an artistic and theatrical family, he took the name Granville from his grandparents' professional stage name. He learned to draw from his father, a painter of miniatures. It was thought that the young Granville surpassed his father's talent and by the age of 10 was drawing sketches for him, which his father passed off as his own. At the age of 21 years old, he moved to Paris, where he began to produce collections of various lithographs, mostly human at this point, until he produced Les Métamorphoses du Jour, or The Metamorphoses of the Day, in 1828-1829. A collection of 70 images featuring people with the heads of animals in various comedic scenes. The drawings were remarkable in their skill for representing human characteristics within animal facial features. Granville was a fierce Republican, even taking part in the barricades of the 1830s July Revolution, which saw King Charles X dethroned. This attitude, combined with his artistic skill, made him a ferocious satirist. He contributed to several satirical periodicals until the reinstatement of censorship laws in 1835. After which, Granville focused on book illustrations, including artwork for Don Quixote and Gulliver's Travels. During this time, he still produced his own lithographic anthropomorphic work, including, and now let's butcher some French, La vie privée et publique des animaux, The Private and Public Life of Animals, Les Cent Proverbes, The 100 Proverbs, and Les Fleurs Animées, Animated Flowers, featuring anthropomorphic plants this time. Rather oddly, after 1833, his work became heavily affected by his wife Marguerite. She was an overbearing woman, and any art that did not meet her high expectation, which was a lot of it, she would take to use as curling papers, which she took great pleasure in. This is part of the reason why originals of his work are so rare today. Granville would remark that Madame Granville has better curling papers than the Queen. Perplexingly, Granville seemed to develop an addiction to these humiliations, and would often remind her of them if she forgot. Marguerite passed away in 1842, and he remarried. Sadly, several of his children died, and their deaths took a toll on his already frail health. He passed away himself in 1848. The destruction of his work, which his first wife started, continued with his son. He revered his father's work, but hated the more fantastical productions, and so ordered them destroyed upon his death. Which means the only copies of Granville's work we have are those that were printed in books, and the artist often commented that he never liked the reproduction quality. Despite this, his artwork is admired today by his contemporaries for the imagination and skill shown. Leading surrealists recognize his more unusual artwork as a predecessor and inspiration for their own work. The band Queen used various pieces by Granville as album covers, including those for The Show Must Go On, Innuendo, and I'm Going Slightly Mad. His art was the inspiration for Brian Talbot's comic series Granville, the setting of which is an alternative history in which France won the Napoleonic War and invaded Britain. The main character is Detective Inspector Archibald LeBrock of Scotland Yard, a British anthro-badger. The video game, Aviary Attorney, a feathery parody of the Ace Attorney games, extensively uses and animates Granville's art.
John Tenniel was born in 1820 in West London. He began his artistic career as a book illustrator before turning to political cartoons and caricatures for Punch magazine. His political cartoons were considered very radical for the time, capturing and ridiculing many of the political changes of Victorian Britain and around the world. He was also very prolific as well, contributing around 2,300 cartoons for the magazine over a 50-year career, having rarely missed a week, and was highly praised for both his attention to detail and use of grotesque exaggerations. When an Oxford-educated poet by the name of Charles Ludwig Dodgson worked on a children's book about a young girl who falls into a nonsensical underground world, his friends advised him to seek out professional artists to provide illustrations, and so he approached Tenniel. Tenniel was given near-complete creative freedom to visually depict the nonsensical world and its inhabitants, and had such a high standard that he demanded the first edition to be recalled because of the printing of his illustrations weren't good enough. Dodgson's book, called Alice in Wonderland, would be published in 1865 under the pen name Lewis Carroll, to overwhelming success for both the author and its illustrator. The depictions still carry a heavy influence for future adaptations, both animated and live-action, and mentioned in our previous Antiques Furry Roadshow. After doing illustrations for its sequel, Through the Looking Glass, in 1871, he continued to work on political cartoons and became the first cartoonist to ever be given the knighthood in 1893. He passed away days before his 94th birthday in 1914.
Louis Wayne was born in August 1860 in London. His father was a textile trader and embroiderer, while his French mother stayed at home and cared for him and his five sisters. He was born with a cleft lip, and his mother was given doctor's orders for him to be kept out of education until he was 10 years old. When he was allowed into school, he often played truant and would wander the streets of London. After this period, he studied at the West London School of Art and went on to teach there for a short period. His father passed away when he was 20, and so he quit to care for his mother and his sisters, all of whom were unmarried. He became a freelance artist and achieved great success. He specialized in drawing animals and countryside scenes. Throughout the 1880s, Wayne's work included illustrations of English country homes and estates, as well as portraits of livestock for agricultural shows. He could draw a wide variety of animals, and at one point he hoped to make a living producing dog portraits. At the age of 23, Wayne married his sister's governess, Emily Richardson. She was 10 years his senior, making the relationship very scandalous at the time. He moved into her home, but their life together was short-lived, as she died 3 years into the marriage after suffering with breast cancer. Prior to her passing, Wayne discovered the animals that would define his career. During Emily's sickness, she was comforted by a black and white cat that the pair named Peter. They adopted the stray after finding him out in the rain. Wayne began to draw sketches of the kitten for her, which she encouraged him to get published. She passed away before he was able to do this, but he continued to draw feline figures. He wrote of Peter the cat, "To him, properly, belongs the foundation of my career, the developments of my initial efforts, and the establishing of my work." Peter's likeness can be spotted in many of his early artworks. In 1886, Wayne published his first anthropomorphic cat illustration, titled A Kitten's Christmas Party, in the Christmas edition of the Illustrated London News. The art depicts 150 cats taking part in various festive activities, such as writing invitations and playing games. These cats remained on all fours and lacked the humanized expressions characterizing his later work. In the following years, his cats began to walk upright, smile wide, and wear fancy contemporary clothing. They would be illustrated playing musical instruments, serving tea, fishing, playing cards, and various other human activities. Such anthropomorphic animals were popular in Victorian England and were often seen on postcards, prints, and in satirical illustrations. Over the next 30 years, he was a prolific artist, At times he produced as many as several hundred drawings per year. He illustrated for roughly 100 children's books, and his work often appeared in journals and magazines, including his own Louis Wain Annual, which ran from 1901 to 1915. His illustrations often parody human behavior, satirizing fashion and fads of the day. On his technique, he wrote, "I take a sketchbook to a restaurant or other public places and draw the people in their positions as cats, getting as near to their human characteristics as possible. This gives me doubly nature, and these studies I think to be some of my best humorous work." He became the chairman of the National Cat Club and joined many animal charities, where he hoped to dispel the contempt that the cat held in England. Along with his charitable nature, he was unfortunately very naive and easily exploited, leading him to be underpaid and giving up copyrights to his work. He was also still caring for his mother and sisters and was often financially unstable. In his later life, Wayne's behavior changed. He became erratic and sometimes violent, which was too much for his sisters to handle. Psychologists speculate he may have had schizophrenia, which may have been caused by Toxoplasma gondii, a parasite present in cat feces. In 1924, he was committed to the pauper ward of a mental hospital. A year later, he was discovered there, and his circumstances were widely publicized. This led to appeals from figures such as H.G. Wells and the intervention of then Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin. He was moved to a better facility with a garden and a colony of cats. This is where he spent his final 15 years in peace. During his commitment, he continued to create art, notable for having bright colours, intricate and abstract patterns. However, his primary subject, cats, was still present. The changes in his art is what leads some to speculate on his mental health. Louis Wain passed away in 1939, aged 79. The previously mentioned science fiction author, H.G. Wells, praised Louis and his legacy. In his own words, "He made the cat his own. He invented a cat style, a cat society, and a whole cat world. English cats that do not look and live like Louis Wain cats are ashamed of themselves."
Arthur White was born on the Falkland Islands in 1881 and moved to London with his father at the age of two. He became an illustrator in the 1890s, and in 1898 his newest creation was published in the women's magazine The Playbox. Jungle Jinx revolved around a group of school children, including Jumbo the Elephant, Jacko the Monkey, Hippo the Hippopotamus, Bertie and Billy Boar, Archie Alligator, Ping Panda, Aussie Koala, and all the antics they got up to, including those against their headmaster, Dr. Lion. At last year's Antiques Furry Roadshow, I talked about the comic strips of Jimmy Swinnerton, and how he basically invented comic strips and the funny animal genre, which by extension paved the way for the anthropomorphic animals in more modern cartoons that appeal to the furry fandom today. Jungle Jinx is historically recognized as the United Kingdom's first funny animal comic strip, and its success helped influence other cartoonists to produce their own funny animal comics, such as Tiger Tim from Julius Stafford Baker, Rupert the Bear from Mary Tortell, Bonds of a Dog by George Studdy, and The Little Sparrowkins from Mabel Frances Taylor, who would take over Jungle Jinx in 1905. Taylor was the major driving force behind Jungle Jinx's legacy, expanding the comics into a spin-off called Dr. Lion's Boys in 1938, and even its own short magazine run, continuing to produce comics for it until her passing in 1947. The comic ran for 49 years, which made it the longest running British comic in history, until taken over by Tiger Tim, which itself was taken over by its current record holder, Rupert Bear.
First appearing in October 1958 in A Bear Called Paddington. This little friend hails from darkest Peru. A refugee to London, he is found by the Brown family at Paddington Station, where he gets his English name from, as his Peruvian name is too hard to pronounce. Paddington is a friendly, polite bear, and although he often ends up in mischief, he manages to charm his way out. Michael Bond, the writer and creator of Paddington, was inspired after seeing a lonely teddy bear in a toy shop near Paddington Station on Christmas Eve in 1956. All of the other toys had been bought, and feeling pity, he bought the bear and gifted it to his wife. He was also inspired by his experiences of World War II, as the couple took in London evacuees and Jewish refugees into their Reading home. This prompted him to dress Paddington similarly to these displaced children, with a small suitcase and label around his neck, reading, "Please look after this bear. Thank you." The little bear was a huge success, with his first book selling out by Christmas, the same year it was published. In 1976, the Paddington TV series debuted, scripted by Bond himself and animated by Ivor Wood, who also produced Postman Pat, The Wombles, The Magic Roundabout, and many other classic TV shows for kids. The show was a stop-motion animation, with Paddington appearing as a 3D puppet, whilst the human characters and settings were all 2D drawings. Airing from 1976 to 1980, the series ran for 56 episodes plus 3 specials. People craved the little bear, and Bond was quick to license Paddington on various products, including books, stationery, vinyl records, and even hot water bottle covers. He was so popular that counterfeits cropped up. In fact, the iconic image of Paddington wearing bright red Wellington boots was actually inspired by these knockoffs. Charlie and Eddie Clarkson, whose son, Jeremy Clarkson, was the first person to own a Paddington bear, excluding the original one, ran a small manufacturing business and began making the bears as presents for their children. The teddies wouldn't stand up on their own, so they gave them toddler-sized Wellington boots to weigh them down. When they began production proper, all the bears came with the rubbery footwear. However, it wasn't long until the solicitors came calling. But, as luck would have it, Eddie Clarkson would meet Michael Bond himself in the lift to the solicitor's office. Bond admired the plush bear so much that he agreed to let the Clarksons continue bear building with his blessing. The pair had struck a deal even before reaching the solicitor's door. Paddington made a few more television appearances, starting in 1989 with Paddington Bear, animated by Hanna-Barbera, then in 1997 with The Adventures of Paddington Bear, produced by the Cinar Corporation. In 2009, he joined other children's television favourites, including Bob the Builder, The Wombles, and Pingu, in the official BBC Children in Need medley. The little bear made his big screen debut in 2014's Paddington, with an A-list cast including Hugh Bonneville, Peter Capaldi, and Nicole Kidman, with Paddington himself being fully CGI. The film was a big hit with the public and critics alike, so much so that in 2017, a sequel was released. Sadly, Michael Bond passed away on the 27th of June 2017, the same day principal photography ended, and so he never saw the final film. The movie is dedicated to him. Michael Bond was laid to rest in Paddington Cemetery, with his epitaph reading, "Please look after this bear, thank you." Paddington wasn't the only talking animal character created by Michael Bond. He also wrote of a mouse called Thursday, another lost animal adopted by a family of church mice this time. After escaping from a home for rodent waifs and strays via a balloon, he literally descends upon the family one fateful Thursday. Olga de Polga is an adventurous guinea pig that Bond wrote a series of stories about in the 1970s. He also wrote the 1970s children's show, The Herbs. This stop-motion animation follows the adventures of various herbaceous characters, including Parsley the Lion, Tarragon the Dragon, and Dill the Dog, an excitable puppy constantly hunting his own tail.
You are all probably aware of a Disney animated feature, The Great Mouse Detective, about a mouse named Basil who works as a detective for the Mice of London underneath the house of Sherlock Holmes in Baker Street with the assistance of a doctor named Dawson. However, you might not know it's based on a line of books.
The Great Mouse Detective is based on the popular book Basil of Baker Street by Eve Titus.
Eve Titus was an American children's author and member of the Baker Street Irregulars, a Sherlock Holmes fan group of writers who believed Sherlock Holmes was a real person and Arthur Conan Doyle was his literary agent. She wrote the first Basil of Baker Street in 1958, with the story of Basil and Dawson searching for the missing twin children of Mr. and Mrs. Proudfoot. While she would write four more books following the tales of the mouse detective and his faithful assistant until retiring in 1982, however, the series was revived with new books written by Kathy Hapke starting in 2018. This wasn't the only long-running series of books featuring anthropomorphized mice written by Eve Titus. Anatole is a series about the titular mouse living in France, working as a night watchman for a cheese factory and living with his wife and children. There are 10 books released from 1956 to 1979 and was adapted to an animated series in the late 1990s. Having survived through the Spanish Civil War, English author George Orwell was motivated to write about his condemnation of totalitarianism and the corruption of socialist ideas at the hands of dictator Joseph Stalin. When his personal written accounts of the war didn't sell well, he decided to turn to fiction, leading him to write Animal Farm in 1944. In the preface, he described the source of the book's setting. I saw a little boy, perhaps 10 years old, driving a huge cart horse along a narrow path, whipping it whenever it tried to turn. It struck me that if only such animals became aware of their strength, we should have no power over them, and that men exploit animals in much the same way as the rich exploit the proletariat. He had a difficult time getting the book published in the UK due to its strong allegories and Britain's wartime alliance with Russia causing heavy political pressure, but he managed to get it published in 1945. In the book, the animals take over the farm from its drunken, lazy owner and run it themselves as a free and fair society. That is, until the pigs get greedy and change the rules to benefit themselves and oppress others, exploiting the other animals and eliminating opposition. Over time, the pigs become more and more powerful, and if not worse, they become closer to their former human oppressors. It was adapted into an animated feature film in 1954 by Harrison Batchelor, who were the first British animation studio to produce a feature-length film, and it was also secretly funded by the CIA with the purpose of promoting anti-communist works of art. Despite being given a more uplifting ending, it retained much of the heavy allegories and unsettling scenes from the book. The film impressed the world for its darker tone, whilst the animation was that of the quality of US animated feature films of the time, a reputation that would be self-evident a couple of decades later. Moving to the 1970s, a man named Richard Adams improvised a story about rabbits to his daughters on car journeys, and they insisted that he should write it down. It was originally rejected 7 times before a publisher took it on as a risk, giving it the title Watership Down. The story followed rabbits of Sandalford, who journey to find a new warren, risking life and death, as well as fighting off a rival warren by the brutally ruthless General Roundhorse. In 1978, it was adapted by Michael Rosen into an animated feature after 3 years of production. And despite cutting out several scenes from the book, it has a strong following thanks to Art Garfunkel's bright eyes and its surprisingly graphic scenes. It was so successful that Mr. Rosen brought back most of the team with the task of adapting another Richard Adams book. The Plague Dogs was Richard Adams' third novel, about two dogs who escape a science lab hidden in the Lake District and are pursued by the government and the press because of fears they may carry a harmful virus. The animated feature adaptation was finished in 1982. Interestingly, although the film's ending is rather open-ended and bleak, it was the ending that Richard Adams originally intended for the novel, before being changed at the behest of his editor and publisher to one that was more uplifting and conclusive. Watership Down has had many more adaptations since, including a 3-season animated TV series in the late 1990s, a London stage adaptation in 2006, and a Netflix miniseries in 2018. When they catch you, they will kill you. But first, they must catch you. Everyone run! Time to talk about furries from behind the Iron Curtain. Jeez, the Russian furries are going to tear me to shreds over this. Russia began experimenting with animation in the form of stop motion in the 1910s, such as the works of ballet master Alexander Shilaev and his ballet dancing puppets, as well as biologist Vladislav Starevich, who began making animated films using embalmed insects. Stop motion, paper cutouts, and puppetry were the primary forms of animation produced through the 1920s and 30s, until they found an influence from a well-known name. In 1935, animated films were submitted by Walt Disney to the first Soviet Film Festival in Moscow, including the Academy Award-nominated short Three Little Pigs, where it won third prize and was described as, and I quote, "the paragon of art, thanks to high artistic quality, graphics, and exceptional musicality." In the same year, the Soviet government sponsored numerous Soviet filmmakers to travel around Europe and Hollywood to study film production. So, for the animators, Disney animation was an incredible influence on their work, utilizing their techniques and building their own tech based on the ones in the United States. A good example of this can be found in the 1948 animated short The Champion, directed by Alexander Ivanov. It's a comedy sports film about an arrogant wolf in a skiing competition.
А ну-ка, Чижик, отойди в сторонку.
Я лучше поднажму, а ты беги в догонку.
Этот лыжник очень хитер. Он хотел срезать дистанцию и терпит аварию.
Here's another one from 1951. Таёжная сказка by Olga Khodataeva. Based on a folktale from the Evenks people about a sly, tricksy fox who outwits two trusting wolverines as they move home.
Уж не знаю, как быть. Муж сказал, сиди здесь.
А ты и будешь сидеть здесь. Я все сама сделаю, все сама. Вот, гляди.
Погоди, Лиса, я с тобой поеду.
Ну что ж, едем. Только боюсь, тяжело будет. Потонем.
For those who know the history of Walt Disney or the Soviet Union, you could correctly assume that kind of influence had a lot of friction with it. Some in the Russian animation industry viewed Walt Disney as a soulless artisan who created endless cartoons featuring Mickey, Donald, and Goofy. Meanwhile, at his own studio, Walt Disney was facing heat from his own staff for being overworked, underpaid, and having very little credit for the actual work they did, and as such wanted to unionize. Walt Disney pinned the blame on communism, accusing the protests as of being the result of communist spies infiltrating his own company, even saying as such towards the US Congress as un-American. Considering the Soviet Union was a communist society, the nation wouldn't have taken his views kindly. Therefore, it's possible to see why by the beginning of the 1960s, animation began to change. The Soviet realism, influenced by Disney animation, lost favor to caricature, and animators became more diverse and experimental. Nowhere is this more evident than with the output of the studio Soyuz Multifilm. Although not the only animation studio, they are the oldest and most prolific in Russia's entire history. If you want something cute and stop motion, you had Roman Kachanov and his series Cheburashka, based around characters created by Eduard Uspensky in 1965, including the titular Cheburashka, a monkey-like child, and his friends, such as an accordion-playing crocodile named Gina.
Gina, я с тобой поеду.
Спасибо, Чебурашка.
Молодец, старик. Не оставил друга. А ну-ка, подвинься. Крокодил, играй.
Медленно минуты уплывают вдаль, встречи с ними ты уже не жди. И хотя нам прошлого немного жаль, лучшие, конечно, впереди. Скатертью, скатертью дальний путь стелится и упирается прямо в небосклон. Каждому, каждому лучшее верится, катится, катится голубой вагон.
If darker and more hand-painted animation is more of your interest, I recommend looking at the work of Yuli Norstein. Jurgik Vertomania is about a hedgehog who gets lost in a fog when journeying out to meet his friend, Bear Cub, an experience that changes the hedgehog forever. Or, if you want something more akin to colourful slapstick characters, look at Norpagedi, created by Vyacheslav Kurtyonichkin. A comedy adventure about a wolf trying to catch and presumably eat a hare, much to the ilk of Tom and Jerry. However, there is one that would most likely come to mind whenever you think of Soviet-era animation. So, the Soviet Union did venture into an adaptation of Western stories, like The Adventures of Mowgli. But one that got incredibly viable in the United States and UK only a few years back involved another beloved British bear, Winnie the Pooh. Winnie Pooh is a cartoon trilogy directed by Fyodor Kitruk, which were adapted from the original books with all the beloved characters except for Christopher Robin.
Отпускай! Ура! Что, здорово?
Ну, на кого я теперь похож?
На медведя, который летит на воздушном шаре.
А на маленькую тучку разве не похож?
Нет, не очень.
Ладно, может, отсюда больше похож. Разве знаешь, что придет в голову этим пчелам? Пятачок!
Что?
По-моему, пчелы что-то подозревают.
Что подозревают?
Не знаю. Но только они ведут себя подозрительно.
Может, они думают, что ты хочешь утащить у них мед?
Пятачок! Кажется, они не верят, что я черная тучка.
А что делать?
Открывай зонтик и ходи взад-вперед. Я буду петь тучкину песню, а ты смотри на меня и говори. Кажется, дождь собирается.
Ага. Кажется, дождь собирается.
Я тучка, я вовсе не медведь, а как приятно тучки.
While it had a notably different tone from the Disney's take on the stories, it has many fans, including Wolfgang Reitman, who directed the Walt Disney Animation's Winnie the Pooh animated film. When the Soviet Union eventually dissolved in 1991, production of animation slowed down dramatically as a result of massive cuts to state funding. Some Russian animators would leave studios more film to form smaller, privately owned animation studios, while others moved over to the West, including some who formed the studio Klasky Chupo, best known for the Nickelodeon shows Rugrats and the Wild Thornberries.
Automatons are self-operating machines designed to follow a preset sequence of movements, often in the form of living things such as people and animals. The first automata date back to ancient Greece, with the inventor Ctesibius crafting a water-powered artificial owl which hooted and moved. These finely crafted machines use cams, rods, and winding motors to come to life, with technical origins in clockworkings. As craftsmen learnt to make the parts smaller and more intricate, the potential for these mechanisms grew, from large bell striker figures in bell towers to something that could fit in the palm of your hand. These machines were made as tools, toys, religious spectacles, or prototypes for demonstrating scientific principles. Originally, these devices were reserved for the rich. After many societal upheavals and the production of cheaper materials, the automaton became more accessible for all, and companies began to produce these novelties as toys. Toy manufacturers attempted to cater to more general audiences with animal figures with varying degrees of uncanny creepiness. From nodding puss in boots to drinking bears and dancing creatures. Older designs were usually donned with real fur and fabrics, but as time moved on, these shifted to painted tin plate and then plastic. Really, we're just featuring them because they're a little bit freaky and we wanted something on par with the peanut vendor monkey from last year's panel. Enjoy! Thank you for watching our panel. We hope you enjoyed taking a look at some obscure, antiquarian animal people with us. This is the sequel to our first Antiques Furry panel, so if you haven't watched that yet, please do go check it out on YouTube. That's all, folks.
Very fascinating indeed. I can't read while wearing this.